Hello, and welcome to the official Infinite Pastlog, our new backlog podcast name, right?
Yeah, that's the one. We pretty much settled on it.
Yeah, we both agreed Infinite Pastlog would definitely work a lot better for a backlog about our past games. And on episode 5 of our Pastlog is we're going to be talking about Batman Arkham City.
It was all a lie. There's nothing wrong with you.
Nice of you to say, but you of all people should know there's plenty wrong with me.
Now, Batman Arkham City came out at the end of 2011. Personally, I owned it since then, well, not long after then, on 360, and barely ever touched it until recently,
yeah.
When I played the Game of the Year edition on Steam,
yeah.
Which is actually an amazing game. It stands up for, I know it's only 4 years ago, but it stands up for its time, and it's very impressive even now.
Yeah, I bought the game after the Game of the Year edition came out. I kind of waited. It had a ton of awards, so it was bound to have another Game of the Year edition. And yeah, I totally agree. It's an amazing sequel. They hit it out of the park with Arkham Asylum, and it went past the moon pretty much with Arkham City, with how big, with like everything they added. It was a bigger map, more combat, more enemies, just everything was bigger in a good way. They weren't even like advertising this game as bigger. Like, they mentioned this is a city, so we're gonna make it feel like a city, like that kind of deal, make it look and feel like a city. But aside from that, they did not, like, Rocksteady themselves in almost all their interviews did not boast about, like, oh, it's a bigger game, it's a bigger game, it's a bigger game. They'd mention it, but all just focus, like, yeah, it's just a, we wanted to make this game as just a better Batman game.
They were just sort of advertising as expanded content.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the big difference I noticed, like, we were chatting about Arkham Asylum last week, whereas with Arkham City, like, it's a nice big city. But the main thing is there's always something to do. Like, everything's on top of each other. There's always something else.
Yep. Always something else. It's not... It is weird, because while it is a city, it's a walled-off... Arkham City is a walled-off prison of Gotham City. This is where all the insane convicts and just normal convicts of either Blackgate or Arkham Asylum from the last game, they all get sent into this walled-off city. While the game map may not be particularly too big, what it does how it stacks itself is it fills the city up and it makes it feel bigger than it is.
Yeah, it's got a lot of depth to it.
Yeah.
You know, like, the big thing that really, for me, like, it is an amazing game, do not get me wrong, but the thing that kind of irritates me is how short the story is, and although there's a lot of side content, it's kind of like filler. There's so much side content, it just feels like maybe if they died down some of the side content and tried to pack in more to the main game, do you understand what I mean? Like, it would have made the experience feel a bit more whole. Because
mm-hmm.
I feel if I just played through the game itself, I'd be done in about 5 hours.
Yeah.
And for the size of what the game is, that's just ridiculous.
I get it. I get what you're saying. Now, like, if you played the game before, there's a thing called Protocol 10. That the main villain, Hugo Strange, no spoilers here. The main villain throughout the game, as you're playing it, mentions, like, Protocol 10 will begin in 5 hours, and it continues on down until you get to, like, the 0 hour. Now, this is not a timed thing, like, the game is not keeping track of your time, and you only have a limited amount of time to stop Protocol 10. This is, I feel like the developers knew, like, how long the game was, and put that in to sort of give you that sense of rush, if you know what I'm trying to say.
Like you're on a time limit.
Yeah, you're on a time limit, so Batman get better finish this before Protocol 10 will happen, whatever it may be.
However, if it said there was 5 hours left, you could still be playing the game for 20 hours, and the announcement wouldn't change.
No, it would not change. My log time in Arkham City as of right now is 36 hours. Now, originally, my log time, because I did do most of the content, was about 25 hours. That's when I beat the game.
Like, yeah.
I beat everything. I understand where you're coming from. There's, like, a lot of side content, but a lot of this side content is actually pretty good stuff. Like, you see a lot of the rogues of Batman's rogues gallery in this game, and that's fantastic. While in the first Arkham Asylum, there were just hints like, oh, here's the Riddler's cell because it's got a whole lot of question marks, and here's the Mad Hatter's cell because it has the top hat. Now you get to actually see these characters, like, in person.
That's the thing that I was kind of annoyed about in Arkham Asylum, is that there'd be riddles relating to these other people, and there'd just be like a photo or something, or something like that. The character wasn't actually there. They didn't have any involvement in the story.
Yeah.
And yet you stumble across a lot of them through the story in Arkham City. Like, the main one is, like, one of the first things you do in the game is you go to the courthouse because you have to save Catwoman from Two-Face.
Yep.
And downstairs in the courthouse is Candyman.
Yeah.
Which, do you know what I mean? Like, that's just really weird and random. But it's a nice addition to the game that there are these other characters that are part of the Batman world that are actually being included.
Yeah. And it's not like these characters are just there for the sake of being there, in the sense of, like, they're in their own isolated world. There is a sense of that these characters are connected. You know, you have Two-Face and Penguin's factions in this prison, or, you know, having a turf war between the two places. And that's actually shown within the game. As you progress through the game, after you beat certain villains, other, like, thugs who wear, like, whoever faction they're a part of, they start taking over those certain turfs, and you start facing more enemies in those turfs, and more variations of those enemies as well.
Yeah, and with that as well, there are conversations between the guards and the mobs in each of the areas. Like, especially when you go into the museum, they're actually saying about, if he takes him, like, down Penguin, I'm going straight to Two-Face and all this stuff.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, I completely forgot about the conversations that everybody has as you're flying through Arkham City. Well, I should say gliding. It's not, Batman doesn't fly. There's a whole...
God, man, get it right.
There are a whole bunch of, like, conversations that Batman can listen on into. And some of this stuff is, like, it's funny in a way of, like, it's a Batman thing. On certain occasions, they make references to... like, old Batman, like, 70s camp stuff, you know, like, with when Adam West was around being Batman. They make jokes and stuff like that, and it's nice to hear those kind of things, and then you also hear it, like, story stuff, a part of it as well. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, things relating to the story, how the status of Arkham City is by the prisoners in there, how they feel.
Yeah, and there's even, like, quite a lot of conversations and talks about, like, Harley Quinn and stuff as well.
Oh, yeah. It's all great. Like, they did such a great job in putting those little details in. It made the world feel a lot more real. Yeah.
And there's even, like, ones with the guards, like, saying they want to have their way with Catwoman and stuff. Mm-hmm. When you're playing as Catwoman, obviously you got Game of the Year edition.
Yeah.
But I think you might even overhear conversations like that when you're Batman, about, like, the guards saying they want to have their way with the Harley. And, like, obviously certain guards just there, like, good luck with that.
Yeah. That's all great stuff. What else is there?
Well, the combat system as well is the next sort of big thing for me.
Oh,
with
yeah.
That game. And how much it actually improved. It stayed the same solid system, but they integrated a lot of the like quick commands.
Yeah, a lot of quick commands selected to your gadgets.
Yeah.
So that was
great. Made it so much better.
Oh,
the addition of the freeze bombs, the electric gun, whilst there, the explosive gel.
Explosive gel that was in the game, but just not a part of the combat.
Yeah, in Asylum, but now it's actually part of the quick command combat, which just makes it so much deeper.
Actually, talking about that, the unlock system was actually a lot better in this game as well. In the first game, there was unlocks for your armor, how well you can deal with physical damage and bullet damage, and then there was unlocks for a couple of, like, combat things, like lower your combo score so you can do takedowns a lot easier. And then the rest of them were gadgets. In this game, there's actually a lot more. You have free flow combat, which starts to slow down your area, so you have a lot better reaction time and you can beat on guys a lot quicker. And you have like free flow gadget use as well, which also helps. Like, there's a lot more for the unlock system in this game, and I love that. That was great. I couldn't wait to like get that level up screen so I can get the next thing for myself. Because the first time
I don't know why, but it felt like it was easier to level up in this one as well.
It was easier.
It felt better paced.
Yeah, I feel it was easier because there was a lot more to do. Because you got XP from just beating up on random thugs. It didn't matter if they were doing anything wrong or not. So.
No. Then obviously there were so many Riddler trophies. There was 440. Yeah. No, 400, wasn't it, for Batman? There was 400 Riddler trophies. Then on top of that, obviously every time you got a trophy, every time you burst like Joker balloon, every time you destroyed a security camera, everything that had anything to do with the Riddler challenges, you got XP for.
Oh yeah, and that like my first 5 hours of the game, I had my my physical. A combat armor all the way up so I could deal with more goons. And talking about dealing with more goons, both you and I played on hard. Now, in Arkham Asylum, when you played on hard, you didn't have the spider sense flash over the opponent's head. In this game, they did add that for the hard mode, but that's because you kind of need it. You fight a lot bigger mobs.
Yeah, without actually getting used to the way Arkham City works, you can't just really go from Asylum on hard without the attack notifications of enemies to not having them on Arkham City, because, you know, in Arkham Asylum, the biggest mob you fight in the whole game is about 15 guys, and that's only if you choose to, and that's when they're all celebrating when you arrive to go fight Joker.
Which was great. It still is a great... That's a great scene. It's a great fight. I love that whole thing.
Whereas you can just get in a fight with some people in the street and end up fighting about 10 or 15 guys in Arkham City. And, you know, they'll be... The AI is much better. They'll be picking things up. They'll be ramming shields, you know. In certain areas, like if you're on rooftops and stuff, they'll have, like, art weapon crates. We try and get guns out. You know, I know there are certain sections of Arkham Asylum, that's when there's literally about 5 or 6 enemies, whereas in Arkham City, there's always a bigger group.
Also, that's without the end content when you start fighting guys with guns. This game, about maybe 20 minutes in, you start fighting people with guns. Not that many, but they're still there.
It adds everything in a lot better, lot better pace. But yeah, it definitely makes it, it's something you need to get used to before you can go to New Game Plus, which doesn't have the attack notifications, again, just like hard on Arkham Asylum.
Yeah.
But you do need that experience prior to be able to take on those mobs efficiently.
Yeah. Also, something added onto the combat, with the Riddler being in the game and the game taking place in a small section of the city, there's a lot of trophies, like you said. And with that, certain guys know where these trophies are. I like the added, Riddler informants that you have to fight in the mobs.
Yeah, you had to interrogate.
Yeah. Well, not even the interrogation, is just how you had to carefully take out the guys around the guy that you wanted, because you couldn't just interrogate him with a whole bunch of mobsters around you. You had to take out everybody.
That made the fighting a bit more tactical. When you had about 8 to 10 people, you had a big crowd of people, and you couldn't attack that guy very much.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you'd knock him out, and that'd be it. You're done.
Yeah. Granted, you could reset. Like, there's a way to trick the game so you could leave the area and then come back, and then he's there. But that's...
Well, yeah, you'd always have another one appear after a while, but still, you want to get them while you can.
Yeah, and I actually like that. That was actually a really cool addition to make the combat more thoughtful, if you get what I'm saying.
Like, yeah, you had to be a bit more thoughtful. It did kind of make you need to use like your batarangs, like when you're doing the fights. If you batarang them, then obviously it stuns them, then you can carry on fighting the other people.
I never actually used my batarang.
Quick batarang was helpful.
I use the batarang in Arkham Origins more now, but that's for a later time. But I actually use the grapple gun and the shock a lot more than anything else.
Okay. I like to use batarangs and freeze.
The freeze, I never actually used either.
But that's mostly for when I'm fighting the mobs that have those in the informants in. Mm-hmm. Purely so I can freeze the informant, or if he's getting close, just batarang him to stun him.
Yeah. Something else to add
just made
on
life a bit easier.
With bigger mobs, there's also they added a lot more variations to the mobs. Instead of just the guy that holds a baton, you know, electric baton, or a gun, you have guys that are armored, you have shield guys, you have the sword guys, which are pretty interesting to fight because you couldn't just easily counter them. You had to wait until they were done with their like three or four swipes before you could attack them again.
Well, it wasn't even that. You couldn't just counter them. You had to, when you normally press triangle to parry if you're playing on PlayStation or Y if you're on Xbox and whatever if you're playing on keyboard and mouse like
right
some weirdo.
It's right click.
Right click. You had to actually release it between each swing to be able to do an instant knockout parry.
Granted, that's
which
an
is
actual unlock.
So hard.
That's a skill lock, yeah.
Yeah, that is a skill unlock, but that is so hard.
It is.
Otherwise, hard. You just hold backwards and hold the button, and you're good to go.
Yeah.
But if you actually want to take that in one, oh, it's so annoying to get the timing right.
But it's so satisfying when you do.
Oh, when I did, I was nearly like fist bump in the air every time.
Yeah. Actually, my favorite enemy type was the armored dude because there was something they added something when you stunned enemies in the previous game. You just sort of beat on them like you'd beat any other thug.
Yeah.
But in this game, they added the when you do your cape stun, when you start beating on a guy, Batman just goes off on him. I love that. I just love how fast he beats on a guy, and I love it when a guy just comes up as I'm beating another dude. Tries to hit me, counter him, and then start beating the other guy back up again. I love that.
It's like a proper fast like gut punch.
Yeah, it's like you said, it's a good gut punch. It feels very comic booky, like it's appropriate for a comic book.
Like the only thing is with those armored guys, I found it quite easy to take them out because just use the finisher.
Oh yeah, I'd use that a lot if I had to deal with big mobs. But if it was like four guys and had one armored dude, I would take my
obviously.
Time.
Yeah. But like I think one thing I really liked about it is I think in Arkham Asylum they overused Titans.
Yes.
I like that they had some forms of Titan in Arkham City, but there was very few.
It was very few, and you know what?
Of them.
They didn't throw you in a tight room.
No.
Because that was their answer in Arkham Asylum. They made it a lot harder. They put a whole bunch of guys in a tight room with a Titan. I hated that.
Yeah.
That was the worst.
It was horrendous. But then there's also the hammer guys. The Russian brothers.
Yeah, Hammer and Sickle.
Yeah, that's it.
Mr. Hammer, and I think just Sickle was the other guy's name.
I thought they were great, but also they only appear at 2 points in the game. But I think that was nice, that added a bit more variation.
Yeah, it's actually 3 points in the game. You fight Mr. Hammer twice, I think Sickle just once.
Oh, right, yeah, I forgot about that. Sorry, my bad.
It's fine, I got you.
And then you fight you only fight a handful of Titans, and then there's the armored guys, and it just adds a bit of variation because you have to take them down slightly differently.
Yeah, and I love that. That was great.
Yeah, and it's only slightly different, but that slight difference makes it.
Yeah.
You're not just repeatedly doing the exact same thing every time.
Oh, yeah. And on top of that, you were saying Arkham Asylum only had Titan fights. This game improved boss fights immensely. Granted, not as many boss fights, but I rather take less good boss fights than more boss fights.
Yeah. Like, in Arkham Asylum, you had Poison Ivy.
Yep.
You had Bane. You had to sneak through the sewers with Killer Croc.
I don't count that. That's
boss
just a
fight.
Level. That's just a challenge.
Exactly.
Level.
Yeah. And then you had Joker at the end.
Who was not really a fight.
No. Just a it was just mob after mob after mob. And then the only other thing was, what's the other one? Arkham Asylum? The scarecrow things aren't really bosses, but you know they're the hallucinatory levels, which you might say.
I would count that in the same. It's in the same pool as the Killer Croc one. It's a challenge level. It's not really any boss fight.
No. Whereas you had in Arkham City, you had the. Where should we start?
I think Miss. Dr. Freeze is the first one. Mr. Freeze? I think he's the first official boss fight.
Yeah, you got Mr. Freeze. You've got the...
You've got Ra's al Ghul.
Ra's al Ghul, we'll leave him till last, because, that fight.
That was a great fight. There's another one. We talked about this. I should have listed it.
We did. We did talk about this. Yeah. I can't even remember. Miss Freeze, Ra's al Ghul.
It was an actual fight, and I'm going to kill myself for not remembering it now.
There is. Wow, we're dicks.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about the Mr. Freeze fight. I loved it.
I didn't.
I thought it was cool. I felt like
it was how it made it more and more restrictive as you went.
Well, there's like, what, seven options that you can do? And you only take down Freeze, like, the amount of times you take him down is like 5. So you do have a little bit of options there.
Yeah, but the more you do, the harder it gets.
Yeah. But it's not supposed to be easy.
That is very true.
Oh, Solomon Grundy. That's who we forgot.
Grundy. Oh, the Grundy fight.
Born on a Monday.
That was so good.
That was
I really enjoyed that. I was not expecting it at all.
Yeah. Even though he's voiced by the Hulk. It's such a weird thing. So the guy who does the Hulk voices in like any animated form, it's the same guy. So weird. But back onto the game here. Ra's al Ghul fight. That was
Ra's al Ghul fight was something else. Like, they really did step the game up a notch there. I just loved how it kept going in and out of the Lazarus pit between each section.
Mm-hmm. It was really good.
It just added such a nice effect to it.
Yeah, it did. Actually, that the Ra's al Ghul thing is the equal to the Scarecrow stuff in Arkham Asylum.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
But aside from that, like, the whole game altogether is really good. The only thing I can really complain about is the Catwoman sections.
Yeah, that's only if you've got the Game of the Year, though.
Or the DLC, like the pre-order DLC, day one thing.
I thought it was pretty poor, personally.
I thought it was too, and especially because Rocksteady themselves and like every gaming website was like, Catwoman is essential to understand the story of Arkham City. If you don't get it, you're missing out, blah, 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 blah. And I was just like, wow. When you actually play the game, she really has no integral part of the story. Even her ending, where she has a choice to either save Batman or walk away, if you do the walk away option, it rewinds you to give you the option again. You literally have no choice.
Which kind of defeats the whole purpose of having a choice.
Yeah, and defeats
now,
the purpose.
Now, I chose to save Batman because, you know, I'm not a dick.
Yeah, it just defeats the point of just having Catwoman there. While she is interesting, she plays a lot different than Batman. Like, her sense of speed and how much damage she can take. They do differ, the two. But aside from that, Catwoman is pointless. I did not like
her. Get 40 Joker trophies.
Oh, she has 40?
Joker? Riddler. She's got 40. 5 of which are physical, I think. Or 4 of which are physical. So that's really quick and easy to do. Her story parts are really short, and her endgame mission is just to collect loot off of Two-Face thugs.
Yeah.
It's that pointless.
Though, you know what? I did like how she moved around in the city compared to Batman. She's like that Spider-Man kind of jumping around. I like that.
I kind of did, but I didn't enjoy having to press a button, like, buttons repeatedly every time trying to climb up a bloody building.
I did. I kind of liked it. The better you did, the faster you got up it.
It got annoying after a while.
I liked it.
But you could just hammer on the button that worked just as well.
Sort of. You do move faster if you do get perfect. I know that.
Only a little bit, though. It's nothing major. Hammer on it and you get quick enough.
So, anything else you want to add?
I don't know. I really enjoyed the sound design.
Sound
music.
Design was actually really good.
It surprised me. I wasn't expecting that kind of quality.
Well, I mean, the first game made so much money, and I remember seeing like a video about the foliage artists, you know, the guys who do the background sound and everything.
Mm.
Like, they had a whole video about that, about them just testing guns in the studio at WB, like one of their sets, and they were just like testing out guns and making a whole bunch of noises. Like, the Batman's cape is actually just like a leather jacket being ruffled around, which is, that's a little thing. I like that kind of stuff. I like how sounds are made.
I know, so do I. It's just so, it's really interesting. But I don't know, I just found it had a good depth to it.
Yeah.
I know it may sound weird, but I just feel like the overall audio and the music just added to the world.
Mm-hmm.
And the overall tone.
Yeah, it worked really well. It didn't feel like, it was weird. It was familiar. It felt like it, the music felt like the Danny Elfman score from, like, the Tim Burton Batman movies. But it also felt like its own thing.
Yeah.
You know? It was a weird mix. It was a nice mix, though.
Yeah, it was just right.
Just right, yeah. Now,
have we got any other sort of big points?
Big points? Not really. I mean, while the game opens up with the Joker and ends with the Joker, it isn't the main story, which was a nice surprise. The game was built definitely on like the hype of like the Joker being back and sort of about Hugo Strange, but what actually happens in the game, I don't really want to spoil it because that is actually a good twist.
Yeah.
It's a really good story. The whole game all together, it really does lock together well. If you go with just the main story, even the side quests are pretty interesting.
Like, yeah, because the thing is, like, as the game goes, like, you first meet Two-Face, then you meet Penguin.
No, you meet Penguin technically first as Bruce Wayne, then you meet Two-Face, then you meet the Joker, then you meet Penguin.
Yeah.
Then you meet Talia, then you meet Ra's.
Yeah.
Then I think you go back to Joker? Yeah, do you? I don't know.
And in between that, you meet Freeze as well.
Yep, you meet Freeze.
But yeah, it's the way it goes, like, there's not a lot of Joker.
No,
really which
isn't.
Is really nice. It actually, because like that's the thing, it doesn't revolve around Joker.
No.
And that's, Batman doesn't revolve around Joker. Like, you know, even if you watch like the Batman films, what was it, Dark Knight, didn't revolve around Joker, even though Joker was the main character. It revolved around Harvey Dent as well, who is Two-Face.
Yeah.
You know, and I really liked that they tried bringing these characters out a lot more. And I'm looking forward to Arkham Knight to see how they do it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was stupid enough to buy the season pass with this game because Rocksteady is really good with adding content. And they promise that they're going to add content for, like, villains entering, invading Gotham. So whatever villain isn't in this game, whatever they add is going to be phenomenal. At least I hope it will be.
Well, I think Scarecrow's the main.
Scarecrow, Penguin, Two-Face, Harley, Poison Ivy, Riddler's also back.
Yeah.
So you kind of more or less have the same people. But again, that's a topic for another podcast. I think
and
we're going to hold off on that one.
Fill. Of course.
For a while.
Other than I think Arkham City was definitely the step up they needed.
Yeah, it improved in every. It was a good sequel in my books. It's a perfect sequel. It improves on what was already established in the game.
Exactly. It didn't change things that didn't need to be changed,
no.
And it added to it in a way that was innovative and kept to the main core.
Yeah, actually, what was they added like lighting, like how Batman could ascend a little bit.
Yeah, they added all the movement, but obviously they had to for the way you got around the city. They added all the extra stuff to the combat, which made it so much better. The extra gadgets, which made moving around a bit better, and also just being able to fight differently and like how you chose to go into a fight.
Yeah, the Predator stuff, we didn't even talk about that. The Predator options were also even better. There was a lot more, like, it being a decrepit city, there was a lot more destructibility in the walls. Not even like concrete walls, there were like wood panels and all that kind of stuff. It was great. They added a lot.
It made thinking about how to get to them a lot harder.
Yeah, and also the enemies.
There was Riddler trophy underneath where Mr. Freeze locked stuff up at the police station.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept trying to get in there with the line launcher, like you did with all the other ones, and actually just had to jump off the top of the building, dive down, and then glide through it.
Yeah.
It took me so long to figure that out.
Because you're so used to how it worked in Arkham Asylum.
I was trying to line launch in, and like I kept going like line launching from miles away, like round corners and round corners and round corners. And I was even directly on it, and it still wouldn't let me go through the panel, because the only way you can do it is by going... diving down and flying up through it.
Yeah. Well, we're kind of out of time here. So we'll see you on the next episode, whatever that may be. Probably Origins. I got a lot to say about that game.
So far, I've got nothing. I haven't played it, but I will soon.
You'll hate it.
Thanks.
Yep. We'll see you guys.
Have a good night. Thank you all for listening. Or day, or morning. Whatever you're doing right now.
Good night.